Kia ora Canterbury and welcome to Canterbury Live on Thursday the 26th November. I'm Andrea Allen and thank you so much for joining us today. Rightio, what did happen on this day? Let's step back in history to 1942.
When I said I would never leave you.
And you never will. But I've got a job to do too. Where I'm going, you can't follow. What I've got to do, you can't be any part of. Ilse, I'm no good at being noble, but it doesn't take much to see that the problems of three little people don't amount to a hill of beans in this crazy world. Someday you'll understand that. Now, now. He's looking at you, kid.
Get my tissues out. Yes, 1942, Casablanca was released today. The movie was set in the Moroccan city of Casablanca during World War II, starring Humphrey Bogart and Ingrid Bergman. It had its world premiere at the Hollywood Theatre in New York. The movie went on general release in January the following year. The film was nominated for 8 Oscars, phenomenal, and it won 3 Oscars, including Best Picture. Love that soft lens. Radio. Next up, birthdays. Look at this rocking nana. Yes, Tina Turner is 76 today, and this picture was only taken a few weeks ago. Isn't she just beautiful? She was born Anna Mae Bullock, singer, dancer, actress, and author. She was raised in the southeastern United States. She is now a Swiss citizen. She was raised as a Baptist, but she mounted her faith with Buddhism, and she does say that that helped her through some very difficult times, and as we know, she did receive a lot of violence during her first marriage, but many happy returns. She's just beautiful. Next up, Rita Ora, 25 today, looking stunning there on the red carpet. British singer and actress, her debut studio album Ora released in 2012. It debuted at number one in the UK. She is currently a coach on the 4th series of The Voice UK, and later that year she is also a judge on the 12th series of The X Factor. And last but not least, here we are, the Queen. Yes, 1992, big things happened with the purse of the Queen. Major reforms in how royalty were funded in the UK was announced. Number one, the Queen of England would now have to pay income tax. And number two, the number of royals who received taxpayers' money would only be the Queen, the Duke of Edinburgh, and the Queen Mum at the time. So there you go. I know, a little bit surly, but anyway, there we go. Rightio giveaways. We have some more movie tickets, thanks to the Hoyts team, for you to win. Very nice indeed. And only a couple of days left to win this wonderful painting from Ira Mitchell Kirk. And to enter, you know the drill, just call through to Anna or Marianne on 379 7100 or go to our website ctv.co.nz competition page. Now, coming up on today's show, how do we manage grief through this time? It is the festive season. Phyllis Brown talks us through it. We are talking about valuations with West End Jewellers, Claire, because she is actually a valuer. So very nice indeed. And Alex is in from Tech Bikes with a very fancy skateboard indeed. But first up, do you have a rental property? Are you thinking about purchasing one? Well, you may just need the skills of my first guest, Marion Smart. Welcome to Canterbury Live, Marion.
Thank you.
And apologies last time. Congratulations, newly engaged.
Thank you.
Fabulous.
Thank you. Very exciting.
It is. It's a wonderful time. Yes, you enjoy every step of it, won't you?
I will. Be busy, but it'll be enjoyable.
Yeah, good busy though, isn't it? Now, a step we could be taking, though, is maybe purchasing a rental property.
Yes.
Or we could have one that needs a little bit of TLC. Is that somewhere where you can step in for us, Marion?
Absolutely. It can certainly help landlords or property managers if they rent it out through a property manager. But, you know, the rental market's not as high demand as it was a couple of years ago when everybody was, you know, moving house while their houses were being repaired after the quakes. So it's a good time to perhaps spend a little bit of money and do it up a little bit to present it really well when potential tenants come through.
So we've got a bathroom here, an image of a bathroom, because a bathroom is one of those things we use so much.
Yes.
And we do look at it probably a little bit more than anywhere else, really.
Yes.
And here we have one here.
And this bathroom wasn't refurbished or anything. Really, it's just a case of making it look warm and inviting. So, you know, the nice colourful towels that pick up the colour in the tiles and just making it look a little bit inviting. So when tenants come through, they can visualise what it looks like and what it could be like for them to live in it. It also looks like a very cared for property. It's very important for landlords to present their properties well and look like they're cared for, because if they do that, then they're more likely to attract a tenant that is going to in turn care for the property.
And that's the key, isn't it?
It is, and then they're more likely to pay more money, you'll get a higher calibre tenant, you know, maybe longer term, and it's just a win-win all round.
So is it hard to bend the arm of a landlord to spend a bit of money then?
Sometimes they're, you know, very financially focused, obviously. It is an investment. But if you think about, if a property is vacant, then they're losing money. Straight away, they're losing that rent every single week. So it can be very worthwhile just spending a little bit of money. Maybe it's a fresh coat of paint, maybe the carpet, you know, those stains in the carpet simply do not come out anymore. So maybe it is replacing a carpet and maybe just one room or something. But it's really worthwhile, you know, spending a little bit of money, and then you're more likely to rent it quickly and make up for it in the rent straight away, you know, rather than it sitting there empty and not bringing in any rental income.
What's your advice to gardens? Different when it's their own garden, but for a rental property?
Yes, I think you need to keep it simple, because if the tenant needs to look after it and maintain it, then it does need to be simple. But it should still be cut back and start from a very good place where it's not, you know, there aren't weeds, it's not overgrown. So really just cut it back, weed it, keep it simple, good lawns, and you know, hopefully then the tenant will continue to look after it.
And as far as colours though in a rental property, what should we think about that?
I think neutral colours are a good look. We were called in to consult on a property that had been sitting unrented for some time. It was a good property, but the carpet was more probably blue and quite old. Wasn't great. So we came in and we put in quite a neutral colour, but darker, so it doesn't show, you know, marks too easily. And we did that, we added some touches to the kitchen and to the bathrooms, and the next couple that inspected it actually took it, and there were a couple of rental applications for that. So it really does, you know, make the difference to, you know, how many people might be interested in the property.
Marion, if we are looking at making a step in to actually purchase a property, would you be open to actually assisting people if they're sort of choosing between properties and they just don't know which would be the best one? Obviously, you see a lot of rental properties and what work.
Yes.
Could you actually assist people with making a decision?
I can certainly assist, yes, in terms of what might need to be done or how they could, you know, best present it for tenants. Absolutely happy to assist with that. They can, you know, get my details from the website, and certainly able to help. Also, if landlords are looking to sell a property, presenting it is just as important, and that's where my business can come in and really help present it to sell it. You know, taking note of the target market that's likely to buy it.
Well, this is it as well, because it may not have had as much love if it was your own property being a rental, so it may just need, as you said, just that little touches to bring it up to specs,
isn't
it?
That's right. If they're selling, it might need a little bit more work. You know, you'd be more willing to spend the money in order to get substantially more when you sell it. So it might need the coat of paint, you know, windows cleaned, carpet steam cleaned, or, you know, replaced, the gardens just a bit more done, you might add bark to it, etc. So whether it's renting or selling, it's certainly areas that we can help with to boost the rent and to boost the value.
Yeah, and that's most important. So to contact Marion, it's very simple indeed. You can go through, a fantastic website is smartpt.co.nz, but you can call Marion 021 775 325. There's never a better time to actually think about now if that beautiful weather is there, really, Marion. Now we're looking
absolutely
at our properties. Good on you. Rightio, stay with us after the break. Claire Andrews is here for one of my favourite stores, yes, West End Jewellers. And Alex is in from Tech Bikes. We're hopping in our bikes.
Kiss the ground, but it will pay the rental on your home.
you may be looking in your jewellery drawer, or you may have acquired a piece and you need to get it valued for insurance pieces. Where do you go? Well, that'll be Claire, West End Jewellers. Hey Claire, how you doing?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
I'm very good. And you are an accredited valuer.
Well, yes, I can do diamonds. I can't do coloured stones, but I'm qualified to do diamonds.
Well, let's just stick with diamonds.
Diamonds are the best things anyway.
So we've got some actually footage of you doing what you do well.
Yes.
So can you talk over us and just talk us through what you're doing? Because it's quite a science, isn't it?
Yeah, it's quite technical. But
and you don't want to be dropping those bits and pieces on the floor.
That we say what you call is pinging them, because they'll fling out of your wee toy.
Let's have a look now. Here we go.
So here it's looking at the fluorescence of the diamond. So that's whether the diamond glows blue. So you have anywhere from no fluorescence at all through to like bright fluorescent blue. Then do things like looking at the colour. So this is comparing it to other masters that are there to figure out what the colour of the stone is.
So you've got different stones to compare?
Yeah, so you have like what's called a master set of stones. So that's a closer look at the fluorescence there. So that diamond is nil to very faint. So you've got to look at all of these aspects evenly and equally. Everything, this is looking at hearts and arrows.
Oh my goodness.
So the way that the diamond is cut.
So you're like dissecting it.
Yeah, basically.
A little bit.
I don't look at diamonds anymore as just being like, oh, it's pretty. I look at it as a full breakdown of what every part of it is. I know, it's quite amazing. So that's through a 10 times magnification loop. So that's showing it to me 10 times bigger than it actually is.
So this is enhancing any flaws, if there's any, for
yes,
you?
Yeah.
Okay, rather than naked eye.
Yeah, so that's so that I can see if there's any imperfections within that stone.
Wow.
It's quite
that's
amazing.
Cool. It's incredible, isn't it, really?
Yeah, it's quite cool.
So why do people come to you then to have those diamonds valued? Is it purely for insurance, or are they concerned?
Mostly it's for insurance purposes. We always say to people, you regardless should have at least your piece of jewellery done at least once. Not necessarily constantly. People do them every year. People do them every 5 years. But you need to have it done at least once, so that then you can actually have a rough idea of what the value is if you lose it in 15 years time, or if it's stolen or something like that, that you have an idea of what the stones are that are in the piece, what the metal was, what it weighed, and a rough idea of what it was valued at the time. It all comes back to the US dollar and things
like that.
Yep. So diamonds and gold are traded in US dollars, so that has a huge impact of what the dollar is doing versus our dollar.
Massive.
As to what the value is. Yeah. So it can fluctuate. You can have a piece that 1 year was valued at, let's say, $10,000, and next year it's at $8,000. That's purely because of the dollar and what I can get those components in for at the US price.
That's frightening.
Yeah.
So how long, I'm going to ask you a silly question.
Yeah.
So we have a diamond ring.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have to take the diamond out of the ring, or
not
you can
always.
Do? No, okay.
Sometimes some settings will completely hinder what you can see, but generally no. It does say on some valuations, and I know some valuers won't value up a stone if it's a higher than, I think it's a VS1, I would have to double check that.
Listen, you're talking
clarity,
your jargon.
But it can't go any higher than that, because claws and settings can reflect within the stone.
Okay.
So you can't grade it as high. If it has a loose diamond certificate, then you can.
So how long does it take for us to get a valuation completed?
We try to allow anywhere from 7 to 10 working days.
Yeah.
It's a long process. It's not something that you can just bring in and sit down and look at for 5
minutes.
So
detailed, isn't it?
So detailed. There's so many components.
Very cool indeed. Okay, and I do have to pop into you. Nudge, wait, actually have a look at something just quietly. Thanks, Claire. And congratulations on the half marathon.
Thank you.
In Queenstown.
It was
good
awesome.
On you. Well done. Rightio, so that is, well, just missed it then, but West End Jewellers, 421 Colombo Street. Remember, I'll say it again, Sydenham Bakery, look over the road, and there will be Claire. Maybe not literally waving out the window, but she'll be there. westendjewellers.co.nz. Now it's time to not hop on a bike, maybe a skateboard. Alex, I'm a little bit excited.
Mm-hmm.
Now, last time we were out, we were on the bikes, so the electric bikes, but I did spot those in the store,
yes,
the skateboards.
Yeah.
These are substantial.
They are. It's a real monster, this one. You can do about 30 kilometres an hour on it if you want to. which is pretty quick on a skateboard.
It's cool, isn't it?
It's really cool.
And now, what are the restrictions with having a motorised or electric skateboard? Is there any restrictions with that?
There are around using them on road. You basically can't use them on the public roads, so they're more of a recreational thing.
So in a park of sorts or away from public access, maybe?
Exactly.
Okay, not running over Dewey Granny on the footpath.
Not that you would, you know.
Not that you would.
No, no.
So let's talk about the wheels, because they are substantial, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah. So these are a solid wheel. We do have versions available with a pneumatic wheel, which is like massive, and they're designed for off-road use. Like even four-wheel drive tracks you can use them on.
So are they black as in like a tyre of sorts?
Yep.
So like a tyre texture?
That's right.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. What I love about it though is you'd think there'll be a cord from the skateboard to the control, but there's not. Do you want to pick that up and just show the folks
so
at home?
So you've just got a wireless controller there and you pull in to accelerate and it's got brakes as well. You can push
out
the brake.
Bullets. There's no,
no
bullets.
No, it's not a gun. and you can also put it in reverse if you want to. Yeah.
Well, that's a bit tricky. Have you tried that?
Actually, yeah, it's actually kind of handy sometimes.
Really?
Funnily enough.
If you give it stuck.
Especially when we're in the shop.
This is an awesome present for that person, say for the dads out there, just quietly, that want to rekindle a bit of their youth.
Definitely.
Very cool purchase. But who is buying these skateboards?
All sorts of people. It is definitely more popular among the guys, although we have sold a couple the ladies as well, who want to have a bit of fun, get out there. They just appeal to so many different people, you know.
And they are a piece of art as well, just quietly. I mean, these are beautiful, just the wood grain, I think, it's just something about it, isn't it, really?
That's right. Yeah, and with these ones, we've left the grip tape off, so you can put any stickers you want or anything underneath and then put the grip tape down
on
it.
You can pimp it.
Exactly, yeah.
Or personalise it to your taste as well.
That's right.
You did talk about and just tease about the off-road, because you do have some that can go on the beach.
On the beach, yes, on loose gravel, like up ridiculously steep hills. I think I mentioned four-wheel drive tracks are quite popular for running them on,
It's a bit of fun, isn't it?
It's awesome fun. Yeah, okay. It's a real rush.
Frightening, Alex. I know you're a dad as well, but next week is December.
Yes.
And Christmas shopping. Now, in your store, there's lots of stocking filler ideas.
We do. We have all sorts of gadgets for bikes, including lots of stuff that, you know, you might not even think of normally for bikes. We've got the likes of cleaners, lubes, all the sort of bike maintenance things, which is very popular for the Christmas season. But also we've got little gadgets. We've got like the cool little cycle computers. We've got little lights that go on the wheels, you know.
I know, things have moved on since Spokey Jokies and all those sort of things, aren't there?
Yeah.
There's so much bling for the children.
Exactly.
Do you have the good old bells?
We have lots of bells, yeah.
Do you?
Yeah. We have a giant bell.
Oh dear.
So if that's what you're into, if you want like a really big bell, we do have a really big bell.
Okay, I'm going to put you on the spot because I know you've got limited space there. If we come to you and want to purchase, and we could make a purchase from a certain person that wears a red suit, and don't want to put it somewhere in the home, can you keep it for us until Christmas Eve?
Yes, absolutely.
Oh, that's good. That's sort of taking away all those little people looking around in cupboards and things like that.
Yeah, okay. Nowhere is safe.
Putting on the spot, 2016, what can you see being the on-trend for wheels?
As far as 2016, we've got a huge demand for these things that a lot of people are calling them hoverboards. It's like a Segway, but it doesn't have a handle on it. So it's just a little board. It's got a wheel on either side and you just stand up on it. And we are getting summoned for 2016.
Whoa, Back to the future.
Exactly.
Coming to tech bikes, very cool indeed. Now, make sure you head down to Alex. Himself and the team are just awesome. But remember, great, great gift ideas for the Christmas stocking. I know a lot of you leave it to the last minute. Tech Bike Shop 16A at Barrington Mall. Sprayden, phone number is 03 331 7075. But just go to the website techbikes.nz. It's very, very informative. Rightio, after the break, we did touch on the silly season with Christmas, but for some of us it can be actually quite a sad time. Phyllis Brown joins us and gives us some strategies on how to make our way through this time. See you soon.
Never know.
It's a bit lovely, this song, isn't it?
It's a beautiful song, isn't it, Bridge Over Troubled Water?
But that's what you're here for today, because you're a bit of average across troubled water, I think.
Thank you.
Well, you are.
I hope to be.
But for this Christmas, we did touch on it, that for a lot of people, they will be still grieving losses, and it'll be a difficult time.
It will. I think that when it comes to anniversaries or really big public events like Christmas time, the loss of someone is quite hard to take, or it becomes more evident to someone that maybe routines or family traditions or family get-togethers, there'll always be that missing component. And I think it's that time where people walk around on tender hooks or on eggshells, not knowing how to cope with presenting themselves or dealing with family members. And it can really add a different type of stress to the Christmas altogether.
And not knowing what to say, Phyllis.
Not knowing what to say. Not knowing what to do. Some people, they might just decide not to have a Christmas at all. I think for some people, they maybe just want to just get past the day, because it is really that family thing. You know, the movies are all family orientated. You know, everything's about family gets together, family, family, family. And so when a member of our family is not there, it's really a poignant time. It's a big time for people.
So how can we cope with it? I mean, what's some things that some tools that can bring us through it?
Well, it's really interesting. I've been listening to some Abraham Hicks on YouTube. We're talking about life after death and the death process. And, you know, obviously she's lost her partner in 2011. And it's embracing the memories, or embracing the time that you did have, or the time that, you know, that you can remember special times. So we can then think about Christmases past, where you would have had a fun time with that person, or a comical time. Then that sort of, it lifts you away from the desolation of loss, or the pain of loss. And it can really bring you up into a place of remembering them before they were, you know, before they became ill, or before they were no longer there, it was a sudden passing. So it is about sort of recapturing some fond memories. I think it does make it easier to cope with.
Okay, and if we do have a friend or a family member that are going through this grief, what's something we can do personally for them? Maybe not in front of everyone, but just for them on a personal level.
I think on a personal level, Andrea, it's asking if they are okay, and asking if it is okay to talk about their loved one. Are they ready to talk about their loved one? Asking if they want to do something different, just because we've always done it in a certain way, even before a particular celebration. Would you want to do something different this year and make it unique, or make it, you know, a new tradition? So that for that person, that, you know, they've got options rather than just following rote or following what has always been.
Yeah, because there's so many different stages of healing.
There is. There's seven stages altogether, and you could be in any stage at any point in time. So from my own perspective, my father passed when I was 4, but I really actually didn't grieve for him till I was 16. It wasn't until I really actually, I know it sounds difficult or a bit silly, really comprehended that he was gone, like he was gone, that I was just stuck with all, stuck with all the anger. I became a very rebellious 16-year-old. But it was all that grief process. And then you move into that stage of accepting and knowing that, you know, they may be still there. You know, if you have that prospect, we're going to look at that next week, you know, life after death, they're still going to hear you, they're still going to feel you, they'll still be around you on some level.
What is our card for the week?
Well,
Phyllis?
Our card, I'm actually still on the angel cards, and it's self-support. So you are supported by your loved ones, even though you might not see them, and look for the support that's around you. Look at your friends and family and see what they can do for you.
Some beautiful advice. Thank you, sweetheart. You definitely have been our bridge today.
Thank you
so much. Hey, tomorrow you are going to spot me learning how to ride a trail bike. Well, the star of it anyway. That's right. We're going to hit the trails, and I'm joined by Freya from the Isaac Theatre. We'll leave you now with Jimmy Barnes and Driving Wheels. See you soon.